Maryland River Compact. And back behind me here, I've got two other friends. I've got Morgan and I've got Annie. And they're also with the Cumberland River Compact. And today we're out at 7 Mile Creek and we're gonna be talking about more of our creek critters. Today we're gonna be looking at 5 specific critters and the different adaptations they have to living in this aquatic ecosystem. So let's go ahead and get started.
Okay, what is a benthic macroinvertebrate? Let's review. Benthic macroinvertebrate is just another name for the small aquatic insects, animals, and organisms that live in the waters of our rivers, streams, and creeks, okay? Now, benthic just means bottom. These animals live on the bottom of the stream. Macro means large. These animals are small, but they're large enough to see in your hand. And invertebrate, no backbone. They usually have an exoskeleton. So there you have it, benthic macroinvertebrates.
Let's take a look at 5 of our favorite creek critters and their adaptations. An adaptation is a special trait or skill that helps an animal to survive and do everything it needs to do. An adaptation can be physical, like gills that help an animal to breathe underwater, or behavioral, like when a skunk gives off a horrible smell when it's startled.
Okay, well today we're gonna look at some benthic macroinvertebrates and we're gonna start off with the EPPs. And that's just an abbreviation for E is Ephemeroptera, mayfly families, P is Plecoptera, stonefly families, and T is Trichoptera, caddisfly families. And we're gonna start with the EPTs because these families only live in the healthiest water and you wanna find mostly these families when you're looking in the creek. So let's start with the E for Ephemeroptera, mayfly. Okay? Let's take, for example, the flat-headed mayfly. A flat-headed mayfly you would usually find in the fast-moving riffle of the stream on a rock, and they like to scrape algae off the rocks to eat that up. And what eats them? Other macroinvertebrates, fish, amphibians, birds, some adaptations. Mayflies, since they're in the fast-flowing water, they're flattened down so they're close to the surface and they don't get washed away. They also have these longer legs they've developed and claws that also helps them to hold onto the rocks in the fast-moving waters so they don't get swept away. And one last interesting note about a mayfly, they may live in the water as larvae for 6 months or more. Then they come out, they emerge, they have wings, and with wings, they only live 24 to 48 hours. So if you're a mayfly, you have to really get into finding your mate and flying around within 48 hours. So that is the life of a flat-headed mayfly. Okay, now let's talk about P's and EPTs. That's Plecoptera, the order of stonefly families. And let's look at a common stonefly. They are live usually in the rocks also, maybe in the faster moving waters, but they also can live in leaf packs and sometimes on woody debris. Stoneflies, when they're younger, they like to eat detritus, and that is just decaying plant matter. But as they get older and grow stronger, they turn into predators and they start to eat other benthic macroinvertebrates. What eats them? Other benthomacroinvertebrates. Also fish, amphibians, birds. Now, the stonefly, they have several adaptations. First of all, they're flatter, their bodies, so when they're in the fast-moving waters of the riffles, they aren't washed away either. Another adaptation, they have a behavioral adaptation, is the stonefly push-ups. And this is something they'll do, it looks like they're doing push-ups. If they feel like they've got low oxygen, they'll do those push-ups, and that brings more water over their gills so they can get more oxygen. Now, as adults, stoneflies live in the water as aquatic larvae for maybe 11 months or so, and then they get their wings, and as adults, they live 3 to 4 weeks. And they are primitive drummers. So what the male and female stonefly does is they take their abdomens and they drum them on a hard surface, and that creates a vibration or an auditory sound so the stoneflies can find each other. So stoneflies, the primitive drummers. Okay, next in our EPTs is the T's, the order Trichoptera. That's our families of caddisflies. And let's look at, like, for example, a northern casemaker caddisfly. Okay, they like to live, sometimes you might find them in rocky areas, but they also like to live in leafy material and sometimes woody debris. And they like to live in water that's a little bit more swifter moving. They like to eat some detritus, algae, some plant material. Sometimes you might find them in some vegetation. Now, for the caddisfly, they are also eaten by fish, other macroinvertebrates, amphibians, and birds. They have some adaptations, a special one, and this is their ability to produce and spin silk underwater that's adhesive. And it has this binding quality where they can bind together little grains of sand and pebbles and little pieces of leaves and twigs, and they can make cases, and they live inside these cases. They are amazing architects, and one thing to note about the caddisflies is some of the case makers, they make cases that are so specific that you can just look at the case they make and you'll know what kind of caddisfly is living inside. Okay, now we'll move beyond the EPTs and let's look at, say, dragonflies. And that belongs to the order of Odonata, and that includes dragonflies and damselflies. But let's talk about the dragonflies specifically for a moment. Now, dragonflies, when you find them in your creek, you're gonna find them sometimes in the bank roots along the edges, maybe in some woody debris areas or some leafy areas. And they can be in water that's moving kind of swift, but they can also be in more still waters. Dragonflies like to eat other odonates and other benthic macroinvertebrates. They are just voracious predators, okay? They will eat almost anything that they can find. And what eats them are other macroinvertebrates, fish, amphibians, and birds. Now, the dragonflies have a really kind of unique adaptation. What they do, since they're such predators, they have this lower lip called the labium. And what it can do is it can extend out. And on the end of that lip are these two little finger-like probes called palps, and they've got jagged edges and spines. So when that dragonfly sees some prey, it can shoot out that labium, grab its prey, pull it back, and consume it. Now, another interesting thing about dragonflies, they spend maybe 1 to 4 years in their larva form, usually about a year, and then they emerge, and they have 2 or 3 months as a flying adult. And as flying adults, they are amazing flyers. They can fly backwards, they can fly forwards, they can hover. They can catch prey in the air, they can catch a live mosquito and eat it on the wing, which means while they're flying. So dragonflies are pretty amazing flyers and also incredible predators. Okay, lastly, let's talk about the order Coleoptera. That's beetles. And we're gonna talk about aquatic beetles, and let's specifically look at the little tiny cute water penny. Okay, water pennies are little round brown beetle larvae, and you usually find them, they're a little bit smaller than a penny, but they do kind of look like a penny, and you usually find them in maybe some of the swifter waters on rocks. Sometimes you can find them on leafy material or woody debris. They like to scrape algae, the thin layers of algae off of their substrate, and they are also eaten by fish, other macroinvertebrates, amphibians, and birds. Now, a unique adaptation of the water penny is it is flattened, just like that flat-headed mayfly or the stonefly, but this is truly flat. They get right up there underneath the rocks in these crevices, and they can really cling tight to those rocks so they aren't washed away in the higher flows. And an interesting note about the water penny is if you go out in a creek and turn rocks, you might not even notice that this little round, brown creature is going to one day turn into a beetle.
So as we can see, all of our creek critters are super important to the food web. So even if one of those critters isn't able to live in our stream anymore, maybe because of pollution or some other issue, it's gonna impact the entire food web and food chain in our aquatic ecosystem. So it's important to make sure we keep our streams healthy so that food web stays intact. We had a great time learning about our creek critters today and all their awesome adaptations. Let's check in to see what we learned. We hope you all join us next time, and we can't wait to see you again soon. Bye!